So what we're going to do here is a few demonstrations involving air and air pressure to try and just remind us that we kind of live under an ocean of air. And it's a little bit analogous to being underneath an ocean of water, although it's not exactly the same, and we pretty much never notice it. Really, the only time we notice anything about air pressure is when there's a change. And for most of us, like, the most common example of that might be changing altitude rapidly in a plane. So I'm going to do three demos right now with this. They're all kind of on the same idea. First, I'm going to do what's called crush the can. So I have here some empty soda cans into which I've put about 10 milliliters of water, a couple teaspoons. And you're going to be able to see a little bit of steam coming up here because the water's boiling. So right now, the can is filled with water vapor and a little bit of air. As the water boils, the can will be filled completely with water vapor. Nothing's happening to the can. It's open to the outside air, so the pressure inside and outside are the same. I'm kind of doing the same thing here with this larger can, which will probably get hotter faster if I turn it on, but you never know. And then we'll see what happens. The third thing I'm going to do is I'm going to see if I can put a balloon in a bottle like this, okay? Which sort of looks easy, but I'll show you that it's not so easy. And some of what I'm doing now is just letting my water boil really well. So if I put this balloon in here, I really have a lot of trouble blowing it up. So we're going to see what happens and how we can do that in a minute. So let's take one of these cans, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to take it off the here, and I'm going to flip it over into this tray of cold water. So the mouth of the can is going to be underneath the water. And let's see what happens. So you might notice two things. One, the can got crushed from all sides. And two, the can got filled with water. Okay, I'm going to try it again. Let's see what happens. Whoops. Try this one. There we go. So notice that the can was crushed from all sides. Air pressure isn't like gravity. Air pressure is in all directions, and that can is about a third full of water. See if the third one works while I got it handy. There we go. Same idea. Crushed from all directions, full of water. So we'll try to explain that. Now, let me see if I can do the balloon in the flask. So I'm going to take a small amount of water, put it in the flask, put it on the hot plate. How's this guy heating up? Not yet. Might have to come back to that. I'm going to boil the water. Okay. Fill this up with steam, with water vapor. And then I'm going to remove it from the heat. So you can see this is starting to boil a little bit. You can see some condensation on the inside of that flask because the top of the flask is cooler. So it's already boiling. I'm going to turn this off. I'm going to very carefully take the balloon, put it over the mouth of this, see if I can get this to work. Then I'm going to take this off. And you'll notice right now it's filling up. Let me put it in the cool water. And you'll notice that the balloon is what most people would say sucked into the flask, but it actually is pushed into the flask. What most of us call suction is really a pressure difference. So what you'll notice now, I'm just going to cool this off a little bit, is that balloon fills up the whole flask. Okay. You could try and do that at home, but you'll never do it. You can take a little soda bottle, put a balloon over the mouth, and you can only inflate it part way. So we'll try and figure out what's going on with that as well. This guy is not heating yet, so we'll come back to that. So here's my large can. This is now filled with boiling water. I'm going to wait another minute or so, and then I'm going to put the lid on this tightly and set it in this tray here, and we'll see what happens. So right now, there's pressure inside the can, there's pressure outside the can, and they're essentially the same. So nothing's happening to the can. But when I put the lid on it and cool it off, the molecules inside the can are then going to move less quickly. They're going to slow down. If they move more slowly, they're going to collide less. So the pressure on the inside of the can will decrease. The pressure on the outside of the can isn't changing, but now by comparison, the pressure on the outside of the can is greater. So let's see what happens. So I'm going to put this lid on really tightly, pick this up, put it in the water. It's just a little cold water, and I'm going to let that. And you can start to see, you might even be able to hear that. That's the can being crushed by the air pressure outside of it. And I can speed it along by cooling it off more. That's the can getting crushed by the air outside of it. I'm going to rotate this so you can see it's just getting crushed by air. That air that's around us all the time that we never think of is pushing on that can with about 14.7 pounds on every square inch. So if you think about how many square inches there are to that can, you'll also notice it's not crushing just down. This isn't a gravity thing. This can is getting crushed by the air pressure. And if I cool it off even more, it'll really crunch. Now, you'd actually have a very hard time doing that by hand. We could let that go longer, but I think you get the idea. So let's see if we can explain the crush the can demo. So initially, I had my hot plate with the can opening and liquid water. The can holds about 350 milliliters, and there's about 10 of water. So most of this is air. I'm going to turn the hot plate on. The water boils, turns from a liquid to a gas, and essentially that pushes the air out. So now I have a can filled with water vapor. The pressure on the inside and the outside of the can are the same, so nothing happens. When I flip that over, now I very rapidly cool off my water vapor, and it condenses to a liquid. Liquids take up many hundreds of times less volume than gases. So what used to be 300 milliliters of water vapor or so is now just a couple drops of water, and the whole rest of the can has nothing in it. It's essentially a vacuum. So the inside of the can now has a much lower pressure. By comparison, the outside of the can has a much greater pressure. So there's a high pressure outside, a low pressure inside, and the can crushes in. In addition, the air pressure pushed the water into that can. It wasn't sucked up, it was pushed up. If you were in an airplane and a giant bird hit the plane and there was a hole, you would not be sucked out of the plane. You would be pushed out of the plane because there's a greater pressure inside than outside. Whether you know if you're pushed out or sucked out, it won't do you any good at 30,000 feet, but at least you'll know what's going on. Okay. A similar thing happened with the balloon in the flask. When I cooled it off, the water vapor condensed, changed to a liquid, low pressure inside, high pressure outside. Let's see if the big can will work for us. So this is called a pressure mat. It's kind of a flexible, rubbery, smooth square. It's 1 square foot. So it's 12 by 12 is 144 square inches. If I put it down on this stool and it lays flat, there's essentially 14.7 pounds of air pressure pushing down on every square inch. And underneath it, there's no air. So now I have a huge pressure difference, and I can use this to lift the chair up. Just another example that we live under an ocean of air, and we hardly ever think about it. So we're going to do a few demonstrations with the vacuum pump. This vacuum pump is designed to take air out of a container. So I'm going to go and actually do a reproduction of an experiment that was done at one time to first demonstrate that somebody could make a vacuum pump and also that there was such a thing as air pressure. And this was done in the town of Germany, or town of Magdeburg in Germany in 1654. And what this guy did was he made an air pump, and I'm going to do the same thing. He took two hemispheres and he put them together. He hooked them up to his air pump just like I'm going to do. Only got two hands, so I'm hooking this up to the hose coming out of the pump. So right now these things separate. Right now there's air inside and air outside, so there's no pressure difference. I'm going to turn the pump on. And you'll notice right now, so you'll have to trust me, but I can't pull these apart. In the original experiment, he had a sphere that was about 20 inches or 50 centimeters in diameter, and he got two teams of horses, and they couldn't pull them apart. It would take about 500 pounds for me to pull these apart. That's the difference in pressure. But I can fix it very easily if I let the air pressure come back in. So if I push this valve, the air comes in. Now there's no pressure difference. So imagine 1654, somebody did that. So here we're going to do a little demonstration of Charles's law. I have a syringe filled with 30 milliliters of air, and I'll zoom in on that in a minute. This is sitting in cold water that reads 10 degrees Celsius. I'll bring that over so you can see. I touched it. It was 10 degrees in there. I'm going to convert that to Kelvin by adding 273. So right now, we have an initial volume of 30 milliliters and an initial temperature of 10 Celsius or 283 Kelvin. I'm going to turn this on high, and I'm going to boil the water. So let me zoom in so you can see, I hope, that the bottom of that plunger is sitting on 30 milliliters. So what we're going to do is kind of look at this two ways. One, we're going to look qualitatively, and then we'll see if we can apply Charles's law and see how well it works. Now, obviously, we're not going to sit here until the water boils, but qualitatively, Charles's law says that temperature and volume are directly related. Okay. As temperature goes up, volume goes up. So we're going to see what happens as this water changes from about 10 degrees Celsius to about 100 when it boils. That's going to take a little bit of time, so we'll have to go do some other demos and then come back. So we're back to our Charles's Law demo. You can see the water's boiling. Okay. The temperature of the water is 99.9 degrees, just about the 100 we'd expect. I'll take it up and show you. It'll probably cool off slightly before you get to it. But we're going to call it 100 degrees. That's 373 Kelvin. And let's see what we should calculate the volume at. So Charles's law says V1 over T1 equals V2 over T2. Direct relationship. T2 was 373. And we should calculate that as just about 40 milliliters. Now it's a little bit hard to see with all the bubbling going on, but that is, there's the 30 right where this pointer is, and we're just about at 40 milliliters. So we've got two things again. We've got a qualitative, temperature went up, volume went up, and we've got a calculation, and that's pretty good. If I connected those two data points, I could then extrapolate and ask myself what temperature would make the volume be zero. And I think you might actually do that as a little activity in class, but that was how absolute zero was originally figured out. We'll do a couple demos here, kind of related to phase diagrams. The first thing I've got is a typical Bic lighter. And if I bring it in, you can see it actually has a liquid in it. But when I release the valve, a gas comes out. So I've changed a liquid to a gas, but I haven't done that by adjusting the temperature. I've done it by changing the pressure. I can do a similar kind of thing by taking some pentane, putting it in here. I'm going to draw a little bit of pentane into my syringe, put the top on, and then I'm going to pull the plunger down. And when I pull the plunger down, I'm going to increase the volume, I'm going to lower the pressure, and I'll actually boil the pentane. So let's see. You can see it boiling. I'll do it again in a minute. So what happens is, as the pressure on top of the pentane is lowered, doesn't stay very long, but as the pressure on top of the pentane is lowered, it becomes easier to boil. And we're going to see a couple demos related to that in a minute, including when we boil cold water. So let's take a look at a phase diagram and see if we can use that to explain the Bic lighter and the boiling pentane. So here's a typical phase diagram. We've got temperature on the x-axis, pressure on the y, our solid, liquid, and gas zones. We've got our triple point, where all three phases coexist. We've got our critical point, where we can't condense a gas back to a liquid. But here's what happens in the Bic lighter. It's also what happens if you have a gas grill tank, a propane tank. Inside the container, the pressure is higher. So we add liquid butane. I lowered the pressure, and if you look at the phase diagram, when you lower the pressure on a liquid, it can turn into a gas. That, okay. I can do the opposite. If I have a gas and I raise the pressure, I can liquefy it without cooling it down. That's very convenient because if you want to ship things, gases take up a lot of space, liquids are much more condensed. So you'll often see condensed gases being shipped on highways. If I have a solid and I lower the pressure, I'll turn it to a gas. This was the basis for freeze-dried food. You take like strawberries. Instead of heating them to dehydrate them, which can destroy a lot of vitamins, you freeze them and then lower the pressure in a vacuum chamber. The water changes to a vapor, goes away, and you've got everything but the water. The original place that was done was for sending people to the moon because the weight of water meant they needed a lot more fuel. And kind of the enemy of rocket launches is weight. Let's come over here now. Here's my vapor pressure curve. So as the temperature goes up, the vapor pressure of any liquid goes up. This happens to be water. One atmosphere, it is here, and we would say that the vapor pressure of water that matches that temperature is the normal boiling point. So the normal boiling point of water is 100 degrees Celsius. When I lowered the air pressure to 0.3 atmospheres or so, my water boiled at much, much lower temperature. So if you're on Mount Everest, water will boil at about 70 degrees Celsius. You'll have boiling warm water. It won't cook food very well. Food cooks because of the heat of the water. But boiling is really a kind of a balance between air pressure and vapor pressure. Things don't just boil when they get hot enough. One thing I can do is I can boil cold water. So let me get my thermometer here. So this water is room temperature water. It's about 20 degrees Celsius. I'm going to put it in the vacuum chamber. And remember, liquids boil when their vapor pressure equals the air pressure around them. So it's pretty hard to change the air pressure around things normally. But what we can do here is artificially lower the pressure on top of the water. Now, normally when you boil things at home, you raise the vapor pressure of water until it equals the air pressure, and we do that by heating the water. But I can also boil water this way. So first off, I can't pick this up now because there's 14.7 pounds of air pushing on every square inch. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna wait a little bit. You might even see the water boiling now. That's boiling water. Okay, I don't think there's any doubt it looks like boiling water. I'm gonna stop it. I'm gonna let the air back in, and then I'll put the thermometer back in again. Now normally, if you had water in your kitchen that had been boiling and 30 seconds later you stuck your hand in it, it'd be 98 degrees, almost over 200 Fahrenheit. And you can see this is 20 degrees again. So that was boiling cold water. There are no tricks to that, but it often gets people. So now let's see what we can do with the vacuum. I'm going to get myself a balloon. I'm just going to blow it up a little bit. Okay. Get my hose hooked up here again. This is called a bell jar. And we'll see how this goes here. It's just a thick glass jar. I'm going to turn the pump on. We're going to create an environment inside this glass where the air pressure is lowered. So now there's a lower pressure. Pressure and volume are inversely related. Boyle's law. And let's see what happens to the balloon. You notice the balloon is getting a little bit bigger, quite a bit bigger. We'll see if it pops. So now the balloon is bigger. I'm going to let the air back in. And the balloon goes back to its original size. I had hoped to find some Santa peeps, but apparently peeps are not available this year. They're another victim of the COVID crisis. So here's a marshmallow. Marshmallows are sugar, gelatin, and puffed air. So this is essentially a bunch of balloons. So let's see what happens when we lower the pressure around the marshmallow. I think you can see, pressure's going down, volume's going up. Let's let the pressure back in. It would have been a lot more fun with the Santa. I think we can all agree. It's kind of a clever little device. This is a potato gun. But it's a demonstration of Boyle's law. This is a potato. You probably didn't need me to tell you that. I'm going to take my potato gun, make a little potato plug here. And when I squeeze this, I'm going to decrease the volume inside this cylinder. Decreasing the volume increases the pressure and pop. Now normally I'd be sitting in my chair just firing away at students as they came in, but this year I can't do that. If you had a really big one of these, maybe you could launch a rocket. Maybe that's why the first Russian rocket was called Sputnik. Probably not. So what we'll do now is a slightly more quantitative approach to the pressure-volume relationship. So Boyle's law tells us that pressure and volume are inversely related. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to take a syringe filled with 5 milliliters of air, and it's at standard everyday pressure. It's at 1 atmosphere. I'm going to put this in here. And I'm going to remove the pressure, and we'll see what happens to the volume. Now, the syringe only has so much room to go, but we'll still be able to get the idea. So we should know before we start, pressure and volume are inversely related. So as we lower the pressure, we should expect the volume to increase. And I think you can see that this is going up. Takes a little time. But the syringe is definitely expanding. We've gone from 5 milliliters. We're now down to about 15. So we've tripled the volume. You can see we've got the air. As the pressure is decreasing, the volume in the syringe is getting larger and larger. Eventually, it's going to hit the top, and that'll be as far as it can go. So let's see if we can zoom in there and get a reading. Let's see. So there we go. We've got a reading of 35 milliliters. So here's what we can say. We started out with the pressure of 1 atmosphere and a volume of 5 milliliters. The final volume was 35 milliliters. So the second pressure is our unknown. Okay. P1 V1 equals P2 V2. 35. And you should get 14.3 milliliters. So we got two things there. We've got the qualitative, pressure goes up, volume goes down, inverse relation, and then we've got the calculation. And that's a great way to check your work. If you can figure out the general pattern, and then your calculation agrees with that, that's probably a good sign. So, one more gas relationship. This is the relationship between pressure and temperature, known as Gay-Lussac's law. We're just going to do this one qualitatively. So what I have here is a pressure gauge and some cold water. So right now, the pressure in there is pretty much standard. It's just about 15 pounds per square inch. And what we're interested in here is the general pattern. So as I heat this water up, and obviously this will take a bit, so we'll have to come back, but as I heat this water up, the molecules inside that metal sphere are going to move faster. As the molecules move faster, they're going to collide more often. More collisions is more pressure, so we would expect the pressure in there to go up. Now, this only works quantitatively in Kelvin. So we can't say we're going from about 10 degrees Celsius to about 100. We're not raising the temperature 10 times. Okay? All the gas law equations only work in Kelvin. So let's let that go for a while and come back and see what we get. So this is now boiling. You can see the water is boiling. And the temperature is 97 degrees Celsius. It'll get a little hotter if I let it go a little bit. But what I want you to see is that the pressure gauge is reading closer to 20. So if you remember, at room temperature, this was reading 15 pounds per square inch, about 1 atmosphere. But now that the temperature is higher, the molecules in that sphere are moving faster, colliding more, and with more energy, so there's a higher pressure inside that sphere, the pressure's 19 psi. So it's gone up about 25% or so. So now it's, 1.25 atmospheres. That's an application or an example of Gay-Lussac's law. Gay-Lussac was involved early on with hot air ballooning because, well, it may not matter how fast you go up in the balloon, it really does matter how fast you come down. What I'm going to do here is make superheated steam. So we all know water at normal air pressure boils at 100 degrees Celsius. So I've got a hot plate here. I'm going to turn it on high. And I've got some water in here. The water is going to boil, change to a gas, and then it's going to go through these copper coils, and underneath them is going to be a flame from something called a Meeker burner. A Meeker burner gets much, much hotter than a Bunsen burner, so the water vapor that comes out is going to go through these coils, get heated, keep going, get heated, and then finally come out. But it's going to be much hotter than 100 degrees, hence the name superheated steam. You might hear a little bit of a whistling sound when it comes out, and then we're going to see, but my goal is to light matches with water. because all that's coming out of here is H2O. So this is going to take a couple minutes to start boiling. I also have a piece of paper, and we'll see just how hot that steam that comes out of there is. So we're going to let this boil and then continue.